This past year has been crazy. I want to invite you to just remember 1 year ago, what were your plans, yeah, for your private life, for your business life? What were your plans for the next coming year? And then think about it again now. Yeah, where did things go? And I'm pretty sure that for you, same as for me, there will be quite some surprises on the way happening. Yeah? So the last year, we really had to be flexible and agile and throw our plans overboard and adapt with a new situation ahead. And this is all, I believe, on top of so many challenges that we face already. So we want to tackle new technologies like autonomous driving, electric powertrains, etc. Then there's market consolidation, now accelerated even further. So the question is, how do automotive companies handle this situation? And I share two examples here with you. So there's, for instance, from Japan, not too far away, there's Nissan. They just announced last year a big cost-cutting program of 20% of their global footprint cost-cutting. Then there's Toyota. They go even further. They want to reduce 23% of their global costs. Some part of this is that they want to invest into digital technologies to reduce the cost, etc. So there's really something going on here. I personally believe if you want to squeeze out some 5%, some 10% of cost, you can do that. You can squeeze your supply chain. You can squeeze your operation. That can work. But if you want to change, if you want to reduce 20 to 30% of cost, you really need to fundamentally change the way how you operate. And I believe digital transformation has a big role to play in this game. I believe that in China, a typical automotive OEM can save over 100 million yuan additionally every year if you take digital transformation in car body stamping and car body manufacturing one step further. And today, I would like to introduce to you three clear concepts, how you could achieve this as well for you. For this, first I would like to step back a bit and I want to take a look how a car body is being developed today. Yeah, if you want to have a new program started from the design until all the way to the production, many departments and suppliers today, they need to work together. But if you're honest, yes, they do work together, but also they don't work together. So every department is in a way separated by silos. Every department has their own KPIs, has their own milestones to achieve. So the organization is split up, in fact. So there's an organizational divide. In addition, every department and every supplier may use different tools to get their job done. So when you develop new design concepts, new engineering concepts, manufacturing concepts, every department may rely on different tools and therefore on a different process model underlying these tools. So when, let's say for instance, for the stamping process, some companies may use Autoform software, yeah, to simulate and improve the manufacturing process. Maybe the finance and costing team, they may use Excel to also model and predict the cost and manage the cost somehow. You will have in design, perhaps some rule of thumb, how a good design could look like for manufacturing. And then in addition, you have maybe on the shop floor some people that just have, they have experience, which is their tool to get their job done. And all those tools are great, actually. They get the work done. However, they cannot work together. They speak a different language. So people cannot learn from each other. People cannot share information with each other. So basically what we do is we pay highly talented and gifted engineers to work out their concepts, but then when it comes to handing this over to the next department or the supplier, a lot of these information and experience is actually lost and not shared. We create waste. And where does this lead us? This leads us that we just leave a lot of potential just laying on the table untouched, untapped. So we don't get the cheapest design, we don't get the lightest design possible, we don't get things done in the fastest possible way. There are plenty of surprises coming up because we cannot really talk to each other systematically on a way. So perhaps let's say purchasing department, they may not be able to utilize the information that we know about this process, the technical requirements that we have, and are actually in a weaker position when they negotiate with suppliers, for instance. And in the end, program management, for instance, they get different data, different reports in different formats and different languages on the same topic. So in the end of the day, they don't know who to listen to. It's very contradicting. And they may even ask themselves, oh, is this the first time we're building a car in this company? Yeah, why don't these information actually add up together? And what we wish to do is we want to break these silos down, and we want to bring everyone and connect everyone on a shared platform. And I'd like to introduce, again, three examples with you how I believe we can do that. For this first, I believe that we must go away from this very traditional water flow chart and become more agile. And I think agility is a term we hear a lot now, mainly in software development and in sales, but very, very little in traditional disciplines like car body manufacturing. So I asked myself, what aspects of agility can we take over? And I think there are three aspects. First, we want to have quick feedback and quick optimization loops. Second, we want to focus on the end result. That's also something we can learn from agility. And thirdly, we want to have cross-functional and self-managed teams. And for each of those cases, I will show you one case how to get there. So for the first case, how should we do quick optimization loops? For this, let's again look at how a car project is handled today. So first, we will move and walk in the sphere of the virtual world and later transfer to the physical world. So first, we develop designs and engineering concepts virtually, purely virtually. Here, we can still very easily make some changes. But then at some point, we enter the physical world. This is when we make a commitment, when we make an investment to manufacture tools, to occupy the press lines, to set up the welding robots. And this is the point where things get very expensive to change these physical things. So the cost of changes goes up a lot in the physical world, and our ability to control and optimize the cost and the risk reduces dramatically. So what we want to do is, of course, we want to utilize this early phase in the design and engineering virtual world where we can very easily make changes, when there's generous space to make optimizations. And this is exactly what, amongst others, one Japanese OEM is doing. Yeah? So this, let's say it's an anonymized case here for confidentiality reasons. So what this OEM is doing is they founded a team called Value Engineering. And value engineering will, let's say, maintain the customer value. We want to maintain the quality or even increase the quality. But at the same time, we want to reduce the cost and get things done very fast. So when we have a new design, a part or an assembly group, we want to see how to improve the design, how to manufacture this part. We ask ourselves many questions. For instance, shall we make this part from aluminum or steel? Yeah, we heard before several times already today, okay, aluminum for lightweighting has 20 to 30% weight saving potential. That's great, but also comes with a downside for manufacturability. We ask ourselves, shall we make this part in-house or buy it from a supplier? Because we have to consider that, for instance, for this part, with these dimensions, with this process, we need a certain press line. Yeah, do we have this press line in-house or which supplier has this? We want to know what process, what stamping process do we do? Shall we do draw forming, crash forming, proc die for this process, considering costs, etc.? Or what welding process should we choose? What spot location and sequence should we use is most suitable for this one? And for all of them, we have to consider quality, cost, and time. Yeah, we don't want to make any compromise on quality usually. Yeah, we want to maintain a high surface quality, especially on the A-class panels. We want to achieve high dimensional accuracy, and we want to have a minimum weight possible. Also, we want to, of course, consider costs and reduce this as much as possible. We want to try to reduce the thickness of sheets, reduce the size of the sheet, yeah, have maybe less draw in and optimize it. We want to reduce, optimize production cost. Yeah, we want to have ideally less operations for stamping fonts. We want to avoid chems, which makes it complicated and expensive to handle, and yeah, reduce the tool cost in this way. And last but not least, of course, we want to get a good design that works in a fast time. We want a process that is feasible, so it does not cause us headache when we go to try out and ramp up the production. We want a robust process that works very well under any scenario, even if there's some noise in the real world environment of the production. So these three things we have to really consider. And there was one project which we did together for an aluminum hood assembly group, which I show with you here as, again, an anonymized geometry in this case. So this is aluminum 6000 part. When we started, this part had a cost of 10 euro and 75 cents, yeah, predicted production cost. And then we, together with this OEM, approached this part very systematically, yeah, for value engineering. So we actually ran a lot of simulations for different scenarios. And we basically made a lot of changes to the process and to the design to improve it. So we looked at aluminum 5000 versus aluminum 6000. We played with the thickness of this sheet from 0.6 to 0.7 millimeter. We used different thicknesses, different gauges to find out what is the best option. We even played around with the shape of the part, yeah, like this radii here for the windshield. We made it bigger and smaller from 5.5 to 8 millimeter. And then you see this red cutouts there, where we have this flange, yeah, for higher stiffness. So we also played around to increase it to 7 millimeter or to leave it out at all. So we ran a lot of different calculations for each of these combinations together. And in the end, identified the best result, the best process and design for us for this case, which can be different for every OEM, for every project, weighting, quality, cost, and time. And as a result, we found a design and a process that could save us 7% of weight, yeah, from 2.8 to 2.6 kilogram, which is quite nice actually, and also could reduce the material cost from 6 euro to 5 euro. And given the high quantity of this planned production part, this is some serious money which we are saving here. And that's also the reason why now when we look at a lot of our customers, a lot of OEMs, they are founding new teams now, new value engineering team, because they understand in this early phase, you can really catch a lot of quite nice potential to optimize quality, cost, and time. The next principle I want to share with you is focus on the end result. So this is an example, quite recent actually, from a famous German OEM, which I show with you. And first I want to show you the traditional way and then show you how we should do it. So the traditional way is when we have, here again, a hood assembly for instance, we optimize the single parts. We want to have every single part inside tolerance. That's the job of the tool shop. That's the job of the press shop. Their job is to get green parts, good parts. And they do a lot of, put a lot of effort in this. Yeah, we see this a lot ourselves. So after several loops of usually compensation, they get good quality parts for on the single part level. However, next, when we go to the body shop, to the assembly, you assemble these perfect parts together, but as a result, you will not get a perfect assembly. You actually still face a lot of headaches. So in the end, the assembly does not yet reach the target. So good green parts don't equal a good assembly. The traditional approach is we will take the hood inner part, because that's usually the stiffest part, which is dominant for the geometry of the assembly, and we will try to overbend it. Yeah, maybe in this direction, maybe in that direction, maybe here, maybe there, maybe 2, maybe 5 millimeter. So basically it's just trial and error. We try again, which is a lot of work because the body shop must go to the press shop must go to the tool shop, and they need to go through the whole chain and try. Maybe fail, and again. So this takes time, this takes quite some effort. So now the new approach that we looked at and did together in a pilot project with this OEM is that we go the other way around. We start backwards. We start with the result. Yeah, because we don't want a good part. We want a good car, actually, right? Or at least a good closure assembly here. So we simulated, yeah, in the virtual world, simulated the single parts. We don't care about compensation at that stage, just keep going. And then started from the assembly. And basically we spin off a simulation and Autoform, let's say this is our new product which we just released this month actually, can tell you based on this assembly how you should, let's say, what is the dominant part and how you should change this geometry to get a perfect assembly. And this is what we did. Yeah. So basically the software told us, okay, this is the new target geometry. So basically you have to make a, let's say, bad part. You have a different target geometry that you want to achieve, which we target at. And when we achieve this geometry, we will get right away a good assembly group. And this is, yeah, what we did. And it worked quite well. For reference, commonly this OEM takes roughly 1 year to get such a tryout loop done for part and for assembly group, and we could save 6 months. So basically there were a lot of engineers who had nothing to do after 6 months, which is not a bad thing actually, yeah? We can focus on the next project. So we did this by reducing two loops, which I commonly use for the tryout on the assembly level, and also two loops on the part level. So this is the power of focusing on the end result first. And the last principle I want to share with you is cross-functional teams. So how can we, let's say, yeah, break these silos? How can we make these different functions work together? I believe we can connect them on a shared platform. When we have one shared platform, yeah, connected data flow, and one shared consistent process model, we can connect people to have the base to work together. And this collaboration has two dimensions. On the one level, we want to connect everything from tool over press to the assembly, to the body shop together. And in the past example, we just saw the power of what this can do. That's one dimension. But then even more importantly, I believe, we want to connect the engineering world with the real shop floor. Because that's, in practice, I think, the biggest divide that we see many times. And for this, we will start first, yeah, by building the digital process model. And here we must really pay attention that we consider real-life constraints, the real-life situation. So engineers must really have an understanding of the real production environment there. And then we must systematically share all data, make it available on the shop floor, for instance, via a tablet, that there is guidance, yeah, like a tryout map, what to do step by step, and also offer an interface to feedback data, yeah, to measure, for instance, what is the real final roughness of the tools, what is the geometry of the draw beads, for instance, yeah, which is very critical, and sometimes which is sometimes manufactured quite differently than intended originally. So we need to have a control loop here so that we have an interface to send back the data so we can compare, identify deviations, and then close the gap to bring both together for the fastest result. The same principle holds true for the press shop. Yeah, we must understand the press forces, for instance, that are at play here and make sure that we really, let's say, have the right environment as we designed or bring both parts together. We must measure, double check really the material properties, thicknesses, if everything is as we planned. And we must interfere and bring any deviations together. And last but not least, in the body shop, also here, the same principle applies. We saw in the morning the GOM presentation, for instance. Yeah, so also here, we want to make some 3D scans to compare what are the real final parts, what are the real dimensions of the assembly groups, and then bring it together, analyze based on our engineering intent in the digital process model to very effectively bring both worlds together to get a robust result right away. I brought you one example where I personally worked on with our team, yeah, here from China. This one is not anonymous, luckily, where we also really embraced this idea of cross-functional teamwork. Yeah, so you see us, let's say, as software people in a way, also getting down and dirty in the shop floor, and this is what it takes, I believe. Yeah, the engineering really must work on the shop floor, and the shop floor guys must understand engineering concepts. Then you can really connect both worlds together effectively. So there's a process for PSA, yeah, for a premium model DS X83. That's an aluminum hood outer and hood inner part, both together. And we did this with the tool shop Pushmold in Chengdu. So we had basically, we did the design together, the engineering concept, and also we helped very closely during the tryout phase to make sure really that the engineering intent is executed exactly as we wanted to. So as a start, we built a very accurate process model. Yeah? Again, the digital process model must represent very accurately what we do in real life. So we did material test, built an accurate material model, which is very vital, especially for aluminum, which is so sensitive to manufacture and sensitive to aging effects, etc. We understood the tribology. Yeah? So we made sure what is the roughness of the sheet and of the tool, and then also made sure that this is how we execute it. We used suitable simulation parameters, made sure we simulate also the process conditions accurately. We modeled very detailed the geometries, including draw beads and every detail in a 3D model. We understood the tool kinematics. So for instance, what is the effect of gravity? How the first part will sit on the operation of the next operation, etc. We used evaluation criteria that make sense in order to know how far can we push this process to its limits. And last but not least, we made a robustness study. Because we want to make sure that this process does not only work one time, but this should really work stable all the time, under any circumstance, even if we have some noise in the material properties, we have some noise in the temperature, etc., so that this process can take it. And we were rewarded with quite a good result, I would say. So first we identified in the virtual phase already, there was very strong spring back, very strong geometric deviations here, which we predicted, even some twist. I think we had minus 2.6 millimeter spring back on one side, plus 3.5 spring back on the other side, so quite some twist. We could compensate this in the virtual world. And then also we were proven right when we did the execution. So on the first tool tryout loop, we got this panel right into quality tolerance right away. And when we look at our customer base in China, a lot of tool shops, they still need many tryout loops actually when it comes to aluminum. Mild steel, no problem. Yeah, works quite fine. But aluminum really causes headache. Quite some companies, they need 9 or some even over 10 tryout loops. So compared to this, doing this on the first try right is quite a powerful result, which proves how cross-functional team collaboration really, really works. So coming to the end of the presentation, I would like you to remember 3 things from my presentation. The first thing is we want quick feedback and optimization loops. And we can do this through value engineering, through virtual optimization loops, as we have seen. Second, we want to focus on the end result. We can do this by optimizing our part production already for the final assembly. Third, we want cross-functional self-managed teams. And we can do this by synchronizing the engineering and the shop floor by connecting them on one shared platform with one consistent process model. And last but not least, I want to also introduce ourselves briefly. Many people know us already. I saw already from Volkswagen and some others actually some Autoform simulations here on the wall. So yes, we are a software company. And let's say we consider us as a platform because we can support functions over the whole value chain, from design, over costing, all the way to tool shop, press shop, and body shop. There's a strong ecosystem because many OEMs and suppliers they use our software already, so it's easy to work inside the industry with our software. And I also want to emphasize that we have strong process competence. We have over 140 engineers that actually not only know about software, but most importantly, they know how to manufacture good parts and assemblies. They have been working for OEMs and tool shops before, so we have a process competence on a technical level, but also on a workflow level. Therefore, in the end, I would like to invite you to think about yourself. Which KPI do you want to improve? And if you have some target in your mind, please talk to us. We would be very happy to discuss and see how we can help you reach your targets. So for everyone here in the room, it's a full room here today, very great. I invite you to visit us on our booth A3, which is right there, with this 3D hologram that you saw. And for everyone who is joining us online, and I saw there are also quite many people visiting us online today, please scan this QR code or give us a call, send us an email, and get in contact with us how to reach your targets. Thank you very much.